the country, a kind of trauma you've experienced here in Florida more than once. And it's interesting to see how people come together in a circumstance like this. We see folks from all over the country step forward and offer contributions. You see up on our screens, waiting to give to the Red Cross. People are doing that all over America, gathering their support in any way they can to help the people that have been subjected to this tragedy. And so please, if you have an extra dollar or two, send them along and keep the people who are in harm's way, who have been in harm's way, who have been damaged either personally or for their property, keep them in your thoughts and prayers. We love all of our fellow citizens. We come together at times like this, and we want to make sure that they have a speedy and quick recovery from their financial and, in many cases, personal loss. Yeah. Now, people coming together is what's also going to happen, I believe, on November 7th. Up until that point, when we get to vote on November 6th, and on November 6th, you're going to see us describe our respective visions for the country. My view is pretty straightforward. That is, I believe that this is a time for America to take a different course, that this should be a turning point for our country, and I say that because I look at where we are, and with 23 million Americans, you think about that. These are real people. These are folks trying to put food on the table. 23 million people struggling to find a good job. That this is something that requires, in my view, a different path than we've been on. Likewise, we have half our kids coming out of college who can't find work. This hasn't happened before in our history. We're at a 30-year low in new business formations. This is a real challenge for a nation that normally grows through innovation and risk-taking and startups of all kinds. We also have one out of six people living in poverty. We need to take a new course. We have 47 million people on food stamps. Think of that. Richest country in the history of the earth, largest economy in the world, and yet 47 million people need food stamps. So I believe that this is the year for us to take a different course. I will bring real change and new reform.
Make sure that our schools
know which schools are succeeding and which aren't. And number two, the federal dollars that we give to states and localities, they're two big buckets. One is called Title I, the other is called IDEA money. Those dollars are going to have to follow the student. So that if a child wants to go to a different school where his or her parents do, they have the capacity to do that. Now, you might be inclined to think that that was just a brilliant idea by me and my team, but the truth is that about a year and a half or 2 years ago, I happened to be meeting in the office of one former Governor Jeb Bush, and I said, what can I do to encourage school choice? And he said, well, you could always connect federal dollars to school choice, which is precisely what I've done. Thank you, Governor. Number four, we're going to deal with the real problems America has, and get entrepreneurs to start businesses, and big companies to decide to expand America and put their dollars here. They're going to have to be convinced that we're not on the road to Greece. Because if they think America is headed for economic crisis, they're not going to risk their life savings or risk their capital to build an America, and invest in America. And that's one reason why it's so critical for us to finally cut federal spending and cap federal spending and get on track to a balanced budget. Small business. We've got to help small business. About two-thirds of the jobs in America come from small business. And so we want to make it easier for small businesses to open their doors and keep in business. And you know, we all understand that to have an economy work and businesses to work and people to be able to hire, that there have to be regulations and laws. You couldn't have people opening up a bank in their backyard and, you know, taking money from their neighbor and setting it to someone up. It'd be a mess. So you've got to have laws and regulations. But you also have to make sure that the regulations are up to date and modern. And they're not designed to be so burdensome that they crush certain competitors. And what's happened over time is that these regulations have made it easier and easier for the great big banks and the big corporations with all their lawyers, but they've crushed a lot of small businesses. We've got it wrong. Regulators have to turn around and help small businesses against small businesses. And one more thing that relates to businesses and jobs, and that's taxation. You know, we have to tax in order to have a revenue, to have a strong military, and to be able to care for people who need our care and can't care for themselves. So we're going to have taxes. We're not going to hold as we can get them. And one of our challenges right now is the taxes we charge small business and big business is a tax rate of 35%. Now that's just the income tax. That's just the income tax they pay. I was with an entrepreneur in St. Louis who has an electronics business, four employees, and he said that he and his son calculated how much they spend in taxes every year of what they earn in their business. And he took the income tax and the payroll tax, and the state income tax, and the real estate tax, and the gasoline tax, and they added it up, and it was over half of what they made. Now that's not very hard, but income tax will make 35%. And he said, now think of this. You risk your life savings to start a business, and oftentimes these businesses don't succeed, but if they do, then the government wants more than half of what you're making. And so that keeps us from creating jobs. By the way, you know what Canada's done? Instead of a 35% tax on businesses, they cut it to 15%. Why? They've done that. And by the way, the Europeans have done it. They lowered their tax rate in many cases down to an average of about 25%. They realized we want businesses here because if there are businesses here, more people have jobs. If more people have jobs, they can pay taxes, and the country's better off. And so what I want to do is bring our tax rate for small business down so it's competitive. All these good things, those five things, take for adults and for young people. Number four, balancing the budget. And number five, being a real champion as a nation of small business. For those things to happen, this is going to require something that Washington talks about but hasn't done in a long, long time. And that is truly reaching across the aisle and finding good Democrats and good Republicans and coming together and finding common ground and working the interests of the American people, not just the interests of politics. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. I was elected governor of a state that was slightly Democrat. You know, Massachusetts. It was not lost on me that I would get nothing done unless I was able to have a relationship of respect and trust with people across the aisle. And I was fortunate. The Speaker of the House and the Senate President, as I came in, were men of integrity. And I remember that the Senate President said to me, you know, the campaign is now over. We've been lucky to do the people's business. He was right. We worked together. We came in, we had a multi-billion dollar budget gap. And yet, instead of fighting each other and trying to blame each other, we recognized both parties took some responsibility for the deficit, and we had to work together. And so we cut spending. We didn't just slow down the rate of spending. We actually cut spending in our state.
Some weeks later, in a paper which described the debris that had been found on the